Hello everybody, welcome to another session of Car One Conversations, one of India's first talk show with historians. And today I have a very special guest, somebody whose picture we have seen, the movie, the Victoria and Abdul film that we all loved. And Shravani Basu is with us, and she has come up with a very new book called The Mystery of the Parsi Lawyer, something that really has engaged me for the past 1 week that I've been reading this. And every page is a mystery. Every page is a new beginning in itself, where you'll get a whole lot of characters, a whole lot of storyline, plot twists, and amazing historical nonfiction in a very new form of narrative that you see. It is like a film that goes, but in writing. So, hello, ma'am. Welcome to the session. Thank you so much for agreeing to do this.
Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure.
So we'll start with your early career. Mm-hmm. When did you decide, or did you have a dream to be a journalist that you are, or mm-hmm. what made you choose this path of career?
Right. Well, I've always enjoyed writing. That was, you know, always there. So I became a journalist long back now. It's been many years. I joined the Times of India in Bombay, and then I, you know, moved to Delhi and carried on. And then I eventually moved to London. And my day job is still journalism. So I enjoy the writing. I enjoy the day-to-day stories. But because, you know, through my stories, I'm always trying to find different stories to tell, you know, something unusual, something people don't know about. And that is the fun of being a journalist. When you're on your own, you know, you're the London correspondent, you have the freedom to do all these things, because, you know, it's not just the politics or business or economics that you're covering. It's different things. So, you know, you can delve into culture, delve into history, which I love. So I, you know, graduated, mastered in history. It's one of my favorite subjects. And I just wanted to combine my love of history with the journalism. So bring the skills of a journalist to a historian and tell very unusual stories and tell them for the people. You know, I didn't want them to be locked up in academic books, though they are literally academic books. They are years of research. They are 4 years of research. And you wouldn't know if you just read the book, but there are loads of footnotes, so you can see the work that has gone into it. So that is how I really started. And you know, after my first book was published in 1999, I then wanted to take it to a more serious level, you know, delve into history even more. And that's when I wrote Spy Princess, The Life of Noor Inayat Khan. It was a biography. And that's what sort of started my journey, really.
Yeah, so all your three books are related to the Raj, the British Raj, and, you know, people of the British Raj. What I found interesting in, I've seen the film Victoria and Abdul. I couldn't read the book, but I've read your third book. What I've seen is you choose characters which are very, they are obscure, they are not that famous, they are unknown. They might be invisible, completely invisible when they were there. But how did you choose, or what made you choose these kind of characters in your books?
Right. So I've written 5 books so far. So the first one was a history of curry, actually, which in a way set my path towards my, you know, towards many other books, like Victoria and Abdul came from there. Because when I was researching that book, I knew that Queen Victoria loved her curries, and I wanted to find out more about the person who, you know, made these curries for her. So that then set me on a quest. And of course, I didn't know anything about Abdul Karim. It took me 4 years to research his life. And it was a fascinating life, because who knew that he played such a central role in Victoria's court at a time when, you know, the empire is at its height. Here is an Indian man, a chap from Agra. He's not a prince. He's not wearing, you know, 3-string pearls and jewelry. He's nothing like that. He's just an ordinary man. And he claims this place, you know, becomes her principal secretary, teaches the queen Urdu, becomes her favorite confidant. So I found the letters. I found her notes in Urdu. I found his diary. It took a long time, many years of really hard work to construct this whole story. But it was worth it. I mean, it's what I enjoy doing. So I finally, when it went out to the readers loved it. It was such an unusual story. And then, of course, we know it was famously made into an Oscar-nominated film. So what could be better?
Yeah, but what fascinates you about these forgotten people from the past?
Yes, so what fascinates me is that these people have played a key role in history and we don't know about them. And you're right that all my books deal with the British Raj. So all my books are pre-partition. They deal with undivided India also because, you know, I travel between all the continents, Pakistan, India. I haven't yet done any story with Bangladesh, but, you know, or Sri Lanka, actually. But anyway, but it's mainly been India and Pakistan that are the main for my books, at least three or four of my books. It's these people have played a key role in history, and that's what interests me. And yet nobody knows their stories. So Noor Inayat Khan, I mean, she was somebody, she was a secret agent in the Second World War. And yet I grew up in India. I had never heard of her. There are very few people in UK who knew about her. There were people who knew about her in the 50s, but you know, they'd forgotten. So 50 years later, I wanted to really bring out her story, flesh out who is this Indian woman, you know, in her 20s, how did she land in the war, you know, middle of the war in Europe? How did she play such a crucial role? And how, you know, what happened in her life? What took her there? What happened? And also, you know, basically how she died. She died in Dachau concentration camp. She was awarded the George Cross. It's the highest civilian honor. Only three women in Britain have got that honor. So why was she not known? And so I really wanted to bring her story out. And now her story is known all over the world. So, you know, I get, there's been people in university, students want to do projects on her, people want to make films, they want to write plays, they want to do so many things. So her story's gone around the world. And it's a fantastic story of a woman, a heroic woman, somebody, an Indian woman who stood up there and fought the Gestapo, fought against fascism. I mean, what could be more important? So her story is always some, you know, a story that I really, really am very close to. Well, that was Noor. Abdul Karim, you know, he was somebody unknown, born on the wrong side of the tracks, a clerk in Agra jail. No glamour. You know, Noor is a secret agent. She's a descendant of Tipu Sultan. There is a certain glamour to Noor, you know, we have to admit. But there is no glamour to Abdul Karim. He is just a very ordinary person. But how does he win the Queen's heart? You know, that itself was a fascinating story. And how she puts up a fight for him, you know, just because everybody wants to get rid of him, how the Queen fights for him. And all that is documented. So I had to read a lot of private papers, diaries, many things. And, you know, that story came about. Really Unknown People was the book I wrote about Indians in the First World War. And that is a story of ordinary peasants, you know, from the hills of Garhwal, Pathans from the Northwest, who then traveled in the war, Sikhs, who traveled in 1914, they traveled to France, they traveled to Flanders, they fought in the First World War. We don't know anything about them, but in these trenches, there were men in turbans fighting. They won Victoria Crosses. So I'm not a war historian, but I like to follow human stories. So I followed their stories. And these are completely unknown people. You know, nobody knew these characters. Mm-hmm. I went to the villages. So I do my journalism as well as my archival research. I went to the villages and I spoke to the descendants of the Garhwalis who got the Victoria Cross. I traced their story. Mm. And that story is in For King and Another Country, which was my fourth book. That's and cool. Then, of course, we have my latest, Mystery of the Parsi Lawyer, which is entirely based in UK.
Yes. You know, talking about your recent release, I was really amazed to read the first four chapters of the book. And how did you come across George Adalji?
Well, it's what I do. I'm always interested in finding new, interesting characters. And of course, I'd heard that, you know, the only case that Arthur Conan Doyle ever investigated personally, wearing the hat of Sherlock Holmes, was a case of an Indian lawyer, George Adalji. And I love Arthur Conan Doyle's books. I've grown up on them. So, and I love reading biographies. So I had read his biographies and George Adalji is mentioned in them. So very small, you know, he's a brief chapter in these books, but he is there. And I knew that this man was an Indian. I mean, what happened? You know, being an Indian myself, these stories just fascinate me and I feel they need to be told. So I went, you know, in 2015, after I finished my book on the First World War, I started researching Italji.
Yeah, so it took around 7 years, 6 years.
It was 5 years, yeah. It was published early this year, 2021, but then the job was done, yeah. The last bit was done last year, the final revisions, yeah.
So when you research about the Raj, there are many historians who have a colonial view of history where they see that the coming of British was actually a good thing. They gave us an age of enlightenment and economic glory and things like that. And there are people who are just opposite to that, who really vehemently oppose the British Raj. What is your take on this? Does British owe reparations to India? The very famous question.
Well, the thing is, of course, I am totally opposed to empire. I mean, that is there in all my books. The racism is in every story, apart from the one on Noor Inayat Khan, where it's a totally different story. But, you know, Victoria and Abdul, they destroyed his letters as soon as the queen died. They got rid of him. They erased him from history. So that is such blatant racism. And of course, then I have the story of George Adalji, and that is basically a story of racism that takes place in a small village in England. It starts in the Victorian period, and the main action happens at the turn of the century, 1906 to 1903 to 1907. But he is championed by the famous figure of Arthur Conan Doyle. So there's always, somebody from the empire, from the establishment, who does champion this person. So I do. You know, history is never black and white. So you always have a character who is championed by somebody. Queen Victoria is a total imperialist. You know, don't get me wrong. There's no doubt about that. But at the same time, she champions Abdul Karim. She champions all the Indians, and she really fights for him. And if that is the truth, and that is written in her diaries and her history, I think that she learns Urdu. You know, she wants to eat a curry. She actually masters, starts writing half a page of Urdu at the age of in her 70s, I think. You know, it's incredible. So we have to give her, you know, the credit for that. And we also talk about, you know, what else she's done, of course. But she is a constitutional monarch, so we can't blame her for the, you know, for everything that's happening. Those decisions are taken by Westminster. And of course, the racism in the society, that is something we look at. And I look at it in fair amount of depth in Mystery of the Parsi Lawyer, as to why, what is the attitude that makes people think that this 28-year-old lawyer, whose father is a vicar, is a foreigner in the village. He's born in this village. He's baptized in this village. He's lived there all his life. He's a lawyer. Why do they think he is doing this gruesome crime, which is going out at night and mutilating animals? He has nothing to do with animals. And yet he's charged, tried, imprisoned for this crime. So I look at what is this society thinking when they are, you know, suspecting him? What is the media thinking? Because I think the media always reflects what's going on in society. It's like a mirror. So we see the media, I write about what the media is reporting about him, how they think he has a face that's oriental, he has a debased jaw, his eyes tell you something sinister. It's all about his appearance. So, you know, they're immediately prejudiced by his color and, you know, his ethnic origins. And I don't spare that. Obviously, I write about what happens. I don't even spare Arthur Conan Doyle, who himself, though he champions George Adalji, he himself in his books has written about Indians as, you know, bandits, groups, thuggy. It's that, you know, image of India that they're either exotic creatures or they're bandits and thugs, and they have treasures to hoard and treasures to hide. So I write about the books that Arthur Conan Doyle has also written, and yet he does champion this cause. And there are also 10,000 other people who champion George Adalji. So that is also important, because these people are not Indians, you know. In UK, they are all white. They are academics, they are legals, and we have to give it to them for sticking up to this man and saying, yes, you know, there's been a miscarriage of justice, he must be set free. So I think it's fair to look at those who've done some good and also just put things in perspective always. And to come to your question of reparations, I don't know where they would even begin, you know. So I won't even try to, an apology would do just fine. I would not even go into reparations, because it's impossible. It's absolutely, you know, it's 200 years of rule. Where do you begin? And frankly, you know, the worst legacy of British rule, apart from the money and the drain of wealth and everything, was the partition, because we are still suffering. The wound still runs. And how do you even get rid of that? So, you know, I don't think they can rewrite history, but they can apologize for what they've done, and they can be aware of what they've done. They should appreciate our history and the contribution we've made to their history.
Yes.
So I think that is important.
Being a journalist yourself, and you know, there is a whole lot of debate that goes in the UK about decolonizing the curriculum, the history curriculum in the UK. How do you see that?
Oh, totally for it. I mean, I'm one of those who totally supports it. So I have been saying that all these stories should be in the curriculum, right from the word, you know, right from the schools. Why is it that children don't know that, you know, Indians fought in this war? Everyone is studying the First World War. And actually, I don't even stop at UK. I also say that in India, we didn't know it either. So there is also lack of awareness back in India for whatever reason. So I think both countries need to be aware, because Britain needs to know, you know, people growing up in Britain need to know that this war was not just fought by them against fascism. This war was fought on the backs of Indian soldiers who came. 2.5 million volunteered for the Second World War. There were women like Noor Inayat Khan, you know, who was secret agents, who fought the Gestapo, who faced the, you know, the most danger that anyone can face, and who sacrificed their lives. So this, you know, this victory in the Second World War, and the victory in the First World War, they were, you know, done on the shoulders of people from the colonies, Indians, Africans, and Indians played the major role because they came in the largest numbers. So that has to be acknowledged, and it can only be acknowledged if it's in the curriculum. You can't have a stray project. I mean, I get requests all the time. People, you know, children want to do projects, school projects, university projects, this, that, 100 things. But it should be in the curriculum. When they go on a school trip to see, you know, they go often from here in the UK, schools go to see the graveyards, you know, they go to the commemoration sites in France and Flanders. It's a regular school trip. They should also go in France, you know, just a few kilometers away is the Indian Memorial. See the Indian Memorial in France, see that other countries and other nations fought for this war. So this is something I obviously talk about a lot here. And the need to make, you know, objects are in museums, that's the way it's been, but we need to explain these objects, we need to explain their origin. And so, you know, yes, there has to be an education starting right from the beginning to let people know.
So would you like to tell us about the research part for this book? How did you research? Did you go to the place, or did you go to the archives? How did you research for the book?
All of these. So the archives are in four places. So there were some archives, which are the Arthur Conan Doyle archives in Portsmouth. So I went there, spent some time in Portsmouth, and then I went to Birmingham, where he used to work as a lawyer. Birmingham Museum has archives. Staffordshire has archives. And then we have the Home Office files in the National Archives in London, in Kew. That is a wealth of information, because that tells you what the Home Office is thinking throughout the whole case, how they are approaching the case. And so it's four archives. So it was a lot of work. By the time I finished, my notes were like, you know, my study was just covered with notes. And of course, I went to Worli. You know, you have to go to the scene of crime. So I went to the vicarage. I went to see where all this happened. What is the distance from the scene of crime, from the vicarage? You know, you have to get a picture of the place. It's changed. It was 100 years ago. So the place has changed. But the vicarage is still there. The church is still there. And it's important for me as a journalist to see these things, then to see George's grave, which is forgotten. Nobody knew where it was. I mean, they knew where it was, but it is completely covered with weeds. And I have a photograph in my book. I spent 4 hours searching for that grave, finally pulled out weeds and then found his grave. So now people know where he's buried. So it's a lot of work, but it combines me in the present finding this with the historical work that I'm doing in the archives. So it was a lot of research. It took 5 years to write this book.
While researching for the book, did you come up with something unique that you did not mention in the book, but was really fascinating and interesting about the character or Arthur Conan Doyle, or you know, the characters of this book?
Well, there's a lot more on Arthur Conan Doyle and his India link that, you know, I haven't put into the book, but I could have, because then it just diverts into, you know, in his stories, what he talks about. So I've just given a few, but there are so many more stories in which he talks about Indians in a totally bizarre way. So, you know, there's a princess in one of his short stories. It's a very, not very well-known short story, the Indian princess, daughter of one of the Tuggi chiefs. But the Tuggi chief, most Tuggis were Hindus because they worshipped Kali. He's all mixed up. So the Tuggi chief is, he has a Muslim name. And of course, what is the most famous Muslim name we can think of? He just names him Genghis Khan. So it's all quite funny. I can't go into so much depth about all that, but maybe I will in further editions. When I had to, you know, you write so much and then you have to pare it down. So I was paring things down. But I discovered so much in the book. So there were plot twists that I was discovering, which I didn't know. And I won't go into all of it, but it also showed up a lot of police corruption and, you know, how they are trying to trip up Arthur Conan Doyle when he's researching the book. So all that was fascinating to see the extent they were going to stop him from investigating this case. So that was the background as well. Yeah.
That's really fascinating. I think you should write another book on Arthur Conan Doyle and his fascination towards India.
So, yeah, yes. It's very funny. I wanted to know him and Parsis. And there's only a mention of a Parsi in one of his books. And the Parsi is a Buddhist. So nothing makes sense. It's a story about three Buddhists who go there to take revenge. Back to the UK. And of course, these three Buddhists have names which are not from the Northeast at all. You know, one is called Ram Singh. One is actually Parsi, and the other third is a Muslim. So none of them have Buddhist names. But they're excellent stories. They're cracking good reads. But of course, all these facts are all muddled in his head. And, you know, he doesn't know that much. But he's very earnest. And it's a story that he's writing at the end of the day, but it has its stereotypes.
Coming back to the book, and if you see this being made into a motion picture someday, who would you like to see as George Adalji?
Oh my God. Let's see. There are so many good actors here in the UK. It has to be a UK, I think, you know, a sort of UK actor of ethnic origin. There are many, so I'm not going to name any, but there's lots of people. It would be good. And who would be Arthur Conan Doyle? That would be fun.
Yeah.
But his father is also very interesting. So George Adalji's father, Shapoorji Adalji,
yes,
who is Indian, is real. He's come from Bombay. I go into quite a bit of depth about him and why he converts to Christianity, what brings him here, how does he become the vicar? All these, for me as an Indian, all these were really fascinating. And I had to find out, you know, I couldn't just write this story in isolation. It's everything that's happening around it and building up to it. So Shapoorji is a really interesting character too.
Yeah, so why don't you tell us about the background of Adalji and why did he leave India?
Yeah, so... the mystery lawyer is, of course, George Adalji, and his father is Shapoorji Adalji, and he is the vicar of this little village in England near Birmingham called Great Worley. He is also the first South Asian vicar in India, in UK, which is in 1876, as way back as that there is a South Asian vicar. So how does Shapoorji, who was born a Parsi in a very traditional Parsi family in Bombay, how does he become a vicar? You know, what makes him convert? It's because he went to St. Xavier's College. And it was really interesting that they found that, you know, Parsis are quite westernized, they're educated. They were looking at these young Parsi teenagers in St. Xavier's College and thinking they were ripe for conversion. And so that was quite interesting. So, a few Parsi students converted and Shapoorji was influenced by them. He then runs away from home. He just, he's so obsessed with Christian texts. He leaves his family who object to it naturally. And he runs away. He goes to the reverend and he says, John Williams, he was the reverend of St. Xavier's College. And he says, baptize me. So he is baptized, he's taken in, he makes a speech when he's just 15 years old, you know, at his baptism, which happens in Bombay. And then he's left his family, he can't go back. So he travels around in India with the Wali tribals, trying to work, you know, doing Christian missionary things. But then he always wanted to go to England and study further. So he writes a book on a sort of Parsi, Gujarati English dictionary. And he sells that. And with that money, he travels to England and he learns, he trains to be a curate. And he's eventually, after 10 years, he's appointed. He marries an English woman and he moves to Great Valley. But of course, the very picture in 1876, it's a small village. It's made up of working class miners. And there is this brown man with a pronounced Indian accent teaching the word of Christ to a white parish. I mean, it's bound to go wrong, right? So everything is going to go wrong. So very quickly, I mean, when the children are barely, George is just 12 when all these hate mail starts and racial abuse, poison pen letters, and it goes on for years and years, and the police do nothing about it. And they think that George has written these letters. The letters are there in the book. So, you know, they're quite horrific, saying they're going to kill George. So it must have been horrible for the family. But there it is, you know, that's what happened. And then George becomes a solicitor. And if events as they happen in Great Valley, suddenly there are killings in this field. Horses are mutilated and they're just lying overnight, you know, with their innards slashed out. It's very gruesome. And again, the police can't find anybody. 6 months.
Yes.
Constantly there is fear in this village. It's called the village of fear. And people are scared. Who is the worldly ripper? He comes at night, slashes cattle, goes away. There is panic in this village. And when you have panic and rumors, who do you suspect? The only odd family in this village. Yes. And they live in the vicarage. It's this, you know, vicar, Indian vicar, his English wife, and three, what they call half-caste children. And all suspicion falls on George. And then the rest of the story. He's eventually arrested, tried, imprisoned, and finally he appeals to Arthur Conan Doyle to help him. And he takes up the case.
Yeah, you have given your history books. These are all non-fiction books based on real historical events and figures. Yeah. You give them the shape of a novel, which makes it more readable, I think, for a wider audience, not just history student, but a whole range of people who really like reading non-fiction. Do you think more such books should come out by historians who are really academic historians?
Oh, definitely. I'm all for it because, you know, we want the books to be read. We want these stories to be known. For me, each story is a story. And I guess being a journalist, you know, we write up everything that we write, isn't it? You add description to whatever is happening. So I'm used to writing in a certain way. And I guess I bring that to my books because there is a story to be told. There is a narrative here. It's not easy because you have so much research material. And at the end of when I'm finally writing the book, I have so much material. How do you structure this? You know, where are you going to start? What are you going to do? How do you tell this story? So, it's a lot of hard work.
You mentioned of you being a journalist just now. And, you know, every chapter is so deeply factual, but also very much accurate on the very detailed, I think.
Yeah.
Does your being journalist and being an investigative, you know, by your soul as a journalist, does that help you bring out the details in the story?
You know, I think it's a bit of both because as a historian, you know, journalists don't usually sit in archives, right? I mean, we are in the field, we're doing that work. We're doing interviews and we're in the field. But the historians sit in the archives. So I combine the two. So I spend a lot of time in the archives. Researching till, you know, your eyes just blur reading these handwritten documents. It's hard work. But I also like to go to the field. So I like to interview people and I like to see the place. So I think I combine both these skills and it's what I enjoy doing. And at the end of this day, a story is a narrative. It is a story. Yes. And whether it's a 1,000 word piece that I do for a newspaper or 100,000 piece that I'm doing, you know, for people to read and stay with, because, you know, they're not thin little books. They are substantial books. I do want them to turn the pages and read and find out what's happening, whether it's Victorian Abdullah, you know, Nur Inayat Khan on a mission in France, or Indeed, you know, Arthur Conan Doyle chasing this case of Georgia Dulce. So it has, they are brilliant stories anyway. So it's not hard to add color and, you know, just tell the story because they are colorful stories. Yeah, it's what I enjoy doing anyway.
So is there any inspiration for behind your writing style? Who inspired you to write in such a style of storytelling and, you know, mixing history with storytelling, bring out such beautiful books?
Yeah, well, I think it's been, you know, great journalists that have always inspired me. As a journalist, I always loved. There is the war historian, war journalist and writer, Martha Gellhorn. She is like, she's legend, you know, her writings. And she went to Dachau, she wrote about Dachau. She was the first woman to enter Dachau concentration camp when it was liberated by the Americans. Her accounts. So when I was writing about Noor and I went to Dachau myself, you know, the Martha Gellhorn's words were coming back to me because, you know, her description of Dachau, what it was at that time, were just coming back to me. And I was just literally following in her steps. So yes, women like Martha Gellhorn, journalists like Philip Knightley, who have all written books as well, you know, absolute masterpiece journalism, such investigative. I mean, Philip Knightley was a real inspiration. He investigated stories, you know, in depth, and he wrote books. He did this fantastic book with Kim Philby. So it's books like that that really inspire me as well. You know, writers like that, books like that. So coming out of the journalism and going into, you know, depth. Ben McIntyre is another journalist. He's with the Times. He does these fabulous books on, again, very unknown characters, mainly, you know, agents, double agents from the Second World War. And it's great fun. They are good to read. Of course, Ben McIntyre is more recent, but I'd say Martha Gellhorn, Philip Knightley, you know, these people who aren't there anymore, but they really set a fantastic path to follow.
Definitely. And as we come to the conclusion of this episode, are you working on any other book? Would you like to give us some sneak peek to that?
Well, at the moment, I have two or three things in my head, but they're right in my head at the moment. Because it's been such a difficult year. All of last year was so difficult with the pandemic. Not just for me, but everybody, you know. So I just need a little time to get back to normal. You know, it's just not been normal for months and months and months. So slowly get back to normal. Many of the libraries were closed for over a year. I was lucky I finished my research. So it was just the writing that I had to do, you know, because the libraries were all closed over here. So yeah, take a little time, but there's always stories in my head. I keep being pressurized that you write about so many things, you never write about Bengal, and I'm a Bengali. So why is it? I said, it's not a conspiracy, they just happened. So maybe someday I should go to Bengal and, you know, think of something. But let's see what I come up with.
Definitely look forward to this. And for those who are watching us right now, this book, The Mystery of the Parsi Lawyer, is now available on Amazon in India. So why are you waiting? What are you waiting for? Just close this video and don't forget to, you know, click the subscribe button and go to Amazon, get this book ASAP, and send us your reviews. If you have, if you have read this book, send us your reviews to karwanheritage@gmail.com. We'll make sure that we'll send your review to Shrabani to really read and get back to you if possible. So thank you so much, Shrabani, for your time, for doing the session. I hope you like the questions.
Oh yes, thanks for having me. I enjoyed the conversation, and yes, I hope the readers enjoyed this book too.
Definitely. Thank you so much, and thank you so much everybody for joining us in this episode. Don't forget to drop a comment, like the video, share the video with your friends, young friends who are interested in history, because books like these, you know, are very important for promoting history among young minds. They do not really want to read heavy books. So I think these books should be very well received among the youth in India and abroad. So all the best to you, and we look forward to your next book very soon, hopefully next year or the next.
takes me a long time to write every book, so it'll be 3-4 years before the next. But thank you so much. It was lovely to be here. Take care.
Thank you so much.
Bye. Bye.